I am going ahead on a very important and the most common topic and the most important topic asked as a long question in undergraduate exams. Most of the time it is confusing what to be written and how much to be covered in a long question on glaucoma. Because when we go to the various undergraduate books, the glaucoma is around 10 pages. And only primary open angle glaucoma itself covers nearly 6 to 7 pages. So most of our undergraduate students, they get confused how much to be written and what exactly the examiner has asked as a long question in glaucoma. So usually the format of a long question in most of the universities throughout the country on glaucoma is define and classify glaucoma. Sometimes they may add the aqueous drainage diagram just for a diagrammatic representation. And then either they will do describe in detail the pathomechanism, types, clinical features and management of. They can put primary open angle glaucoma or they can give primary angle closure glaucoma. But primary open angle glaucoma has been more commonly asked and it is more important, and it is for the undergraduate purpose, it is the most common presentations also clinically. So the long question usually framed in university is, I repeat, define and classify glaucoma with aqueous drainage diagram, describe in detail the pathomechanism, types, clinical features and management of primary open angle glaucoma. So in this question we have three, we can divide in our mind in three different sections. First section we will do definition and classification. Second section we will see what is the pathomechanism and types of primary open angle glaucoma. Third thing will be clinical features of primary open angle glaucoma, and the fourth part is management of primary open angle glaucoma. So when we write the long question, usually it is of between 10 to 12 marks. Some universities they go up to 15 marks for long question. So all these three sections will be given different marks. Usually definition classification gives 3 marks, then the clinical feature 3 marks, and then pathomechanisms and management 4 marks, 5 marks, like that they divide. So we'll go one by one. So what is the definition? Definition is, the open angle glaucomas are a group of chronic progressive optic neuropathy having common characteristic morphological changes at the optic nerve head and retinal nerve fiber layer in the absence of, this is most important part, in the absence of other ocular diseases or congenital anomalies, progressive retinal ganglion cell death and visual field loss are associated with these changes. This is the most accepted definition given by the European Glaucoma Society in 1998. Various undergraduate books, they have given various definitions, but the most accepted still is the European Glaucoma Society definition. Then we have to write, what is glaucoma? Glaucoma describes the number of ocular conditions characterized by raised intraocular pressure, optic nerve head damage, corresponding loss of visual field. Many students, they just write damage to visual field, but they have to write corresponding damage, loss of visual field. Then we have a small line about IOP. What is IOP? Depends on the relationship between aqueous production and aqueous output. A normal intraocular pressure is between 12 to 21 or 11 to 21, some books they mention. Normal fluctuation in ocular tension is 3 to 5 millimeter of Hg during the course of the day. This is called as diurnal variation. Now we come to the aqueous autonomic control of the aqueous secretion, how the aqueous is produced. Cholinergic mechanism probably is not involved in the control of intraocular pressure. It is mainly the adrenergic receptors. They do regulate the intraocular pressure. And what are the adrenergic receptors? They are alpha 1, beta 1, alpha 2 and beta 2. But in IOP, the main intraocular pressure is controlling is alpha 2 and beta 2 receptor. in these two receptors, they have got exact opposite mechanism. Alpha receptor stimulates the inhibition of autonomic control. That is, it decreases the intraocular pressure. So, aqueous production is decreased and there is increased prostaglandin F2 alpha. On contrary, the opposite mechanism is by beta receptor. When they get stimulated, they activate the autonomic control mechanism and they increase the intraocular production, aqueous production. So that's how they increase the intraocular pressure. So we have to remember here that mainly it is alpha 2 and beta 2 receptors. So when alpha receptor is stimulated, intraocular pressure decreases or aqueous production decreases. And beta 2 receptor is stimulated, then the aqueous production increases and the intraocular pressure increases. How it is drained, how aqueous is drained, because there was a small tag of probably 1-2 marks will be given for that, that we have to draw a diagram of aqueous drainage. Aqueous drainage. Usually 90% of the aqueous, it leaves the eye through the trabecular meshwork. 10% leaves via unconventional route that is called uveal sclera. Trabecular meshwork is modulated by glucosamine glycan and calcium ionic extracellular membrane. Inner wall of endothelium of Schlemm's canal provides most of the trabecular resistance to the outflow. Trabecular meshwork resistance is mainly given by the inner cell wall of the endothelium of Schlemm's canal. Similarly, the inner scleral and episcleral venous flow also provide resistance to the outflow. So what here we have to remember mainly is that 90% of the aqueous drainage is by trabecular meshwork and 10% drainage is by unconventional route, that also the most common is uveospiral. So now we come to the third portion of the question, that is the diagram. I hope the mechanism, this is not working. The slides are not moving. Yes, Kavya, can you help me out in this? That the my slide.
Sir, you just tap on the screen twice.
Okay.
Thank you.
Now the third part of that question was draw a diagram of aqueous drainage or aqueous output. Here we can see the diagram. This diagram, this part is the cut part of cornea, and this is the iris. And this is the lens, crystalline lens, these are the junules. This particular portion, this dotted portion is, this we can draw with a pencil, black and white diagram. This is trabecular meshwork. So what we have shown here is the red arrow, A. A is the conventional outflow, which is 90%. That is why trabecular meshwork. Then, that unconventional is uveosclerosis. Uvea is the iris part and this is sclera. So, 10% goes from uveal outflow, uveal scleral outflow. Some part is absorbed by the iris directly, which is very minimum, let's say less than 1%. So this diagram we have to draw because they have asked for a specific diagram. Here we have to show cornea, here we have to show the iris, then we have to show the ciliary body, here we have to show the lens and sclera. Then we can show arrow mark by which we draw the conventional uveal scleral and iris segment. So these three we can show the diagram. Now the second part was classification. Classification, the diagnosis of glaucomatous optic neuropathy is mainly based on optic nerve head examination and up to certain extent on visual field analysis. So basically how they are classified and how they are diagnosed. All the forms of glaucoma are classified into primary and secondary. This part you have to remember well, that all the glaucomas, they are mainly broadly classified into primary glaucomas and secondary glaucomas. Mainly based on the gonioscopic finding that will decide about the anterior chamber angle, whether the angle is open or that angle is closed. then associated ocular and extraocular pan. They are also help in deciding whether these are primary glaucoma or secondary. Congenital, so what we can go is basically three part classification. First is congenital and developmental glaucoma, which cover primary congenital glaucoma without associated anomalies. Secondary is developmental glaucoma with associated anomalies. Second portion is primary adult glaucoma. In primary adult glaucoma, it is primary open angle glaucoma, primary angle closure glaucoma, and primary mixed mechanism glaucoma. And the third portion of classification is secondary glaucoma. Primary congenital forms are further divided as primary congenital glaucoma, primary infantile glaucoma, glaucoma associated with congenital anomalies. This is basically picture of a primary congenital glaucoma, where we can see the size of the cornea is big, and this right eye, this is duophthalmic picture. So this is primary congenital glaucoma. Next is primary open angle glaucoma, adult glaucoma. So in primary open angle glaucoma, it could be primary juvenile glaucoma, primary open angle glaucoma, normal tension glaucoma, and ocular hypertension. They come all under primary open angle glaucoma. What are the secondary open angle glaucoma? Go to right, pseudo exfoliation glaucoma, pigmentary glaucoma, lens induced open angle glaucoma, glaucoma associated with intraocular hemorrhage, and uveitic glaucoma. These are the glaucoma which come under secondary open angle glaucoma. Then these are the pictures of uveitic glaucoma. Here we can see these all KP, and then there was all uveitic pictures with peripheral synovitis, posterior synovitis, and corneal edema. This is pseudo exfoliation glaucoma. This material which is deposited here, white chalk like material, which is called exfoliation material. So this is a pseudo exfoliation glaucoma, a type of secondary open angle glaucoma. Next comes is primary angle closure glaucoma. Primary angle closure glaucoma includes pupillary block mechanism, placo iris mechanism, chronic and intermittent angle closure glaucoma, malignant glaucoma. Some books they classify this malignant glaucoma as secondary angle closure glaucoma, and some books they say this as primary angle closure glaucoma. So this is the angle closure glaucoma, where we can see the placo iris, iris bombae, and the aqueous is trapped in the posterior chamber, and there is the aqueous flow obstruction which leads to rays of intraocular pressure. Secondary angle closure glaucoma is a secondary angle closure with pupil block, or secondary angle closure due to pulling of the anterior chamber angle. So that is neovascular glaucoma, aniridia, or inflammatory angle. Here I have shown the picture of secondary glaucoma. Here there is iris, this pupillary block. This pupil is blocked because of posterior synovitis. You can see this 1, 2, 3, 4. This is called occlusion. This is a slit lamp view. This is a gonioscopy. Here we can see there is no angle structures are seen. So this is the type of secondary angle closure block. Now the main part of the long question. We have covered definition and the diagram of angle closure, diagram of aqueous outflow, and classification. That much part of the question is now we have covered. Now the second part of the question was describe in detail about the pathomechanism, types, clinical features, and management of primary open angle glaucoma. So primary open angle glaucoma, we'll go one by one. What is pathomechanism, what are the types, what are the clinical features, and how we manage this primary open angle glaucoma. So primary open angle glaucoma is characterized by, this is a type, you can say this is the introductory part or the main part of the primary open angle glaucoma, where we write all the features of primary open angle glaucoma in just 3 points. Development of glaucomatous optic neuropathy in an eye with a normal appearing mechanically opened anterior chamber angle and absence of other ocular or systemic disorder. So what we are trying to write here is there will be optic neuropathy with mechanically open angle without any anomalies, without any ocular anomalies or systemic disorders which can cause optic nerve damage. So that is what is called primary open angle glaucoma. Here are the pictures of normal retina. As you can see, this is a normal optic disc. These are the dimensions given. That is the distance between the fovea and optic disc is 3.4 millimeter. This is the size of the optic disc, 1.76 vertical and horizontal dimensions. But down picture you can see here is, this is the picture of optic nerve with an advanced open angle glaucoma, where the central portion is whitish compared to this normal disc you can compare. These pictures you will see in coming slides also. Most cases of primary open angle glaucoma are associated with statistically elevated intraocular pressure. This is in the continuation of the first introductory part of the open angle glaucoma. Primary open angle glaucoma is also called as chronic open angle glaucoma or simple open angle glaucoma. You can call it as chronic, open or simple open. It is the most common form of glaucoma, primary open angle. Then you can write it is a typically bilateral disease, but it may be asymmetrically both sides. Unknown etiology, unknown pathomechanism. It is asymptomatic until there is the visual field loss is advanced. Usually the intraocular pressure is more than 21 millimeter of HE, which is the normal without any treatment. Optic nerve head usually have characteristic damage as I have shown you in the two slides before. Visual field shows corresponding field damage. Gonioscopy examination will show open angle which is not occludable and it is no gonio dysgenesis. There is no dysgenesis on the in the anterior chamber angle. Here are the findings that when we measure the intraocular pressure by using occlonation tonometry. So the intraocular pressure is more than 21 millimeter of HG. When we do gonioscopic examination, you can see all the five structures of the angle. So this angle is open and it is as normal as any other eye without any glaucoma. There will be optic disc changes. You can see this. The paleness of the disc in the central portion, the CD ratio has increased. There will be visual field loss, this blackish portion. You can see there is visual field loss. This is the arcoid kind of lesion. What are the risk factors for open angle glaucoma? Increased intraocular pressure. Specific race, some they say these Asians and Hispanians, they have high chances, even Negroids. The chances of open angle glaucoma is high. Advanced age, more than 40 years. Female gender, high myopes, family history of glaucoma or visual loss, or there is any optic nerve head structural changes. These are the main risk factors associated with vascular diseases. Vascular diseases like hypotension or hypertension, vasospasm, or rheological abnormality where there is RA factors positive. Fire could be diabetes mellitus is a doubtful risk factor, but many books they say that in diabetes there is high chances of developing primary open angle glaucoma. Cigarette smoking and hypothyroidism, these are the main risk factors for development of primary open angle glaucoma. Pathophysiology. Pathophysiology is mainly what they say is the elevated intraocular pressure is the main culprit which will produce the glaucoma or the optic nerve head change. Elevated IOP almost plays certainly plays a significant role, but the process is poorly understood. There are two theories has been proposed till now. One theory is mechanical theory, the other theory is vascular theory. In mechanical theory, the chronically elevated intraocular pressure, it will distort the lamina cribrosa plate which will crimp the axons of the retinal ganglion cells as they pass through the lamina cerebrosa, and they eventually kill the these neuron ganglion cells. That's how the damage to the optic nerve head occurs. So mechanical theory says. So this we can see that there is direct damage, because direct damage by the pressure, these nerve fibers, when they pass from this plate of the cerebrosa plate, there is damage to these nerve fibers. Second, there will be interference of the exoplasmic flow because of capillary occlusion. This is vascular flow. That says that the elevated IOP reduces the blood flow to the optic nerve stalks. The cells of the oxygen has got lack of oxygen and nutrients, that is exoplasmic flow, and they get damaged. And this damage to the optic nerve head you can see here. Next is clinical features. Clinical feature symptoms, usually, as I told you in the first slide, it is a silent keep of vision. Silent keep of vision because it is asymptomatic till the optic nerve head damage is advanced. Visual field loss is advanced. The person is unable to see the peripheral things. Then only they come to the clinician and they say, sir, I am. Then also they don't have any symptoms like pain or blurring of vision or redness or watering, nothing much. They say, sir, I am unable to see two objects when they come, or while driving the car, I am unable to see the objects just crossing the road. So, usually asymptomatic because it is a silent keep of vision. And new cases are usually identified by screening. In a routine screening after the age of 40 years, when we screen for the optic nerve head and the intraocular pressure, then only many cases got detected where the intraocular pressure is more than 21 and they are showing the changes in the optic nerve. Very few people, very less number of patients can complain of broache or headache, that too very occasionally. Some may complain floaters, but definitely many complain after 40 years of age, many complain that they are having frequent change of reading glasses. Like they will say, the reading glasses I just made 6 months, 3 months before, 5 months before. That time my reading number was say around plus 1.25 and suddenly then increased to 1.5 or 1.7. But my wife or someone else, the number is still the same for reading. So that's how they come. Many they come with this complaint after age of 40. Some may say, hello, they will see around the light, or in the night driving they will have some problem. On examination, intraocular pressure is usually elevated. It can be even double, that it can go up to 40. When we see the slit lamp biomicroscopy and we see the optic nerve head, there will be increased cup-disc ratio. Mild disc pallor is also seen. We can see the nerve fiber damage and progressive optic disc cupping. These are all findings we see on slit lamp biomicroscopy with an antidiaphragm. What is excavation? The central disc excavation is diffuse loss of nerve fibers. This excavation means like digging, so that slowly that nerve central portion of that cuff is enlarging eccentrically like this. So enlarge concentrically, initially may be difficult to distinguish from large physiological cuffs. That large physiological cuffs are up to 0.8 or 0.7. It is very, initially it is difficult, but when we compare the previous record of the same person, then we will come to know that the central portion of the disc is enlarging concentrically. Then there will be localized cupping. Localized cupping means there will be focal loss of nerve fiber. There will be notching at superior end, which is more common. Excavation is vertically oval at inferior poles. And there will be double ambulation of blood vessel, which is called as biometric. So, what we can see is central cupping excavation, or we can see localized. Then, this localized cupping increases and enlarges when there is a diffuse loss of nerve fiber. This excavation enlarges, only leading to concentric cupping. There will be nasal displacement of the central blood vessel. As we can see in this picture very clearly, these central blood vessels which are coming superior and inferior, they are shifted towards the nasal, towards this side. which is temporal side, which is nasal side. So these vessels, they are shifted nasal. In the advanced stages, the all neural disc tissue is destroyed and it becomes this white. You can see the color of this pinkish orange, and we can see this color as white. This white, obviously. When all the neural disc tissues are destroyed, this is white and deeply excavated, atrophy of the all retinal nerve fibers, the striations are absent, blood vessel appear dark and sharply defined. Here you can see the blood vessel, you can't differentiate vein and artery, and they are very dark and defined color. In this, they are not well defined, but they are shifted nasally. But the color of the disc is slightly orangish. Here it is dark. Progression of cupping. This picture is made gradually, the cupping, how the cupping progress. This first picture is A, normal cup, that is normal CD ratio 0.2. Then the picture B, there is concentric enlargement. Here you can see what is the concentric enlargement. Here the cup disc ratio is 0.5. Then there will be inferior expansion. You can see here there is inferior expansion of this concentric enlargement. Then there is superior expansion. This portion is also expanded. Then there will be advanced cupping. As you can see, this all entire area is converted into cup. Then there will be total cup, which is 0.9 or 100% cupping. Then there will be loss of all retinal nerve fiber. Nerve fiber damage. See, we can see this picture. This is a this blue area. This is nerve fiber direction. This white blue. These are blood vessels. These bigger ones, thicker ones are blood vessels. These thin, thin blue lines are nerve fiber layer. This is a normal picture. We can see slit defect. Here we can see the slit defect when there is nerve fibers are lost. Here we can see a wedge defect. See this portion. See this portion. In this we can't see the striations of nerve fiber. Here we can see, but here we can't see. This is a diffuse wedge defect has occurred. Then when the total atrophy both the sides, here also and here also, you can see there is these kind of nerve fiber lines, blue lines are not seen. They all appear as a single opaque brown color. So this is a total atrophy. Now we come to the visual field loss. The main thing is optic nerve head damage, visual field loss. Visual field loss is up to 50% of ganglion cell axons entering the disc may be lost before there is any disc or field changes are evident. Peripheral field is progressively lost. Acuity is but the visual acuity is affected. Visual field examination is done periodically to note the progressive changes, because this visual field loss is not in a 1 day or 2 day process. It is a gradual process. Initial ring scotoma and residual temporalization of vision is seen in and the stages of loss. When there is all the peripheral visual field is lost, that we will see now one by one. So early visual field defect, these two pictures. Early, this is early visual field defect. Early is a small arcuate scotoma which tend to elongate circumference. This portion we can see reddish. This is a small arcuate scotoma, black color. This black color arcuate scotoma is circumferentially enlarged later on. Here we can see isolated paracentral scotoma. There is a Ronis cup. You can see this. A little enlargement of this iso paracentral scotoma. Next stage, now we see here. This is enlargement of it. This is called arcuate scotoma. There is a formation of arcuate defect. This is enlargement of the nasal stem, which was here, has increased here, nasal stem. And development of the temporal wedge. This is a temporal wedge. Then this will enlarge further. Now here you see. There will be peripheral involvement also. This was, which periphery was involving here and here, now this temporal remains constant, but nasal, it merges with the central portion. So, peripheral breakthrough, appearance of fresh arcuate infiltration. In advanced visual field defect, there will be ring scotoma. Here we can see that entire area, central this area is involved black. Entire ring scotoma. And there will be only residual central island, this white portion. Only there will be the central portion will of vision will remain. In further advanced stages, even this peripheral and central spread, there is only temporal iris. The person can see only the temporal here. But even the central portion is gone in the very advanced. Who are the primary open angle glaucoma suspects? Primary open angle glaucoma suspects are optic nerve head and visual field are normal or suspicious. Peak intraocular pressure is more than 21 mmHg but less than 30 mm without any peak. Or there is IOP difference of more than 4 mm of Hg between the two eyes. Or there are associated vascular risk factors like hypotension, hypertension or urological anomalies. So those vascular risk factors are associated. Or there is a primary open angle glaucoma in a fellow eye. Or anterior ischemic optic neuropathy in fellow eye. These people, the person having these problems are called as glaucoma suspect, primary open angle glaucoma suspect. Now comes the last part of the question, that is how to manage this. Glaucoma per se, as I told you, is raised intraocular pressure which will lead to optic nerve head damage. That optic nerve head damage will lead to visual field defect. Correct. Can we change this optic nerve head damage changes? No. Which has already occurred. Or visual field defect, which has already occurred. So what we can alter is intraocular pressure. Our main aim of management is to decrease the intraocular pressure. Once we decrease the intraocular pressure, then it will lead to less damage to the optic nerve head. Less damage to optic nerve head will eventually cause no visual field defect. So progressive disc cupping and field loss up to primary open angle glaucoma is at a variable rate. This is the most important part of the management, because in some patients the rate of progression of optic nerve head damage and visual field defect at a particular intraocular pressure is different in among two individuals. So the rate of the progression is different. Some patients, they have profound loss in a very less duration, and some people, they tolerate higher intraocular pressure for a longer duration. So the management also differs. So our main aim of management is to decrease the intraocular pressure sufficiently to arrest the progressive visual field loss. How to investigate? We have to do non-contact tonometry to measure the intraocular pressure. We have to analyze the visual field by automated perimetry, gonioscopy for anterior chamber angle, optical coherence topography, OCT, to see the optic nerve head and nerve fiber layer thickness and their structural damage. Tachymetry for the central corneal thickness, because that also affects the intraocular pressure and the management of decrease of intraocular pressure. We'll do routine blood examination for CBC, ESR, do thyroid and lipid profile, especially in cases of hypertensive patients. We'll do blood sugar examination to rule out diabetes mellitus. How this glaucoma is managed? Mainly, glaucoma is managed by two modalities. Two modalities are medical treatment and surgical treatment. In medical treatment, we give mainly the drug which decreases the intraocular pressure. So what are the drugs? The first initial basic drug started was, as we learned in the first slide, how the alpha receptors and beta receptors, how they work. And alpha receptor stimulation works and beta receptor stimulation works, or beta blockers. So on based on those receptors, the medical treatment is based. Topical beta blockers are the mainstay as the first line of treatment, medical treatment for primary open angle glaucoma in almost all type of cases, except the persons who are having bronchial asthma or some respiratory distress problems. There the beta blockers are not prescribed. In all other cases of primary open angle glaucoma, the first line of treatment is beta blockers. Beta blockers like Vimalol, Propiolol, Cetaphil. Some MCQs or some books nowadays giving that prostaglandin analogs are the first line of treatment for primary open angle glaucoma, but the older books and the older codes was considered beta blockers as first line of treatment. So you have to keep both them in a priority basis, prostaglandin derivatives like latanoprost, bimetoprost, and cell. Next comes is adrenergic agonist, right? Brimonidine. We can give topical carbonic anhydrase blockers. They are dorzolamide and brinzolamide. We can give it in oral form also, oral carbonic anhydrase inhibitor when the IOP is very high and we have to decrease the intraocular pressure in a very fast and immediately. In those conditions, we give orally this carbonic anhydrase inhibitor, acetazolamide. Usually, acetazolamide is given for short duration and for immediate lowering of the intraocular pressure. But in primary open angle glaucoma, the main stay of line is topical beta blocker, prostaglandin analog, adrenergic agonist, and topical carbonic anhydrase blocker. Next comes is surgical and laser treatment. Laser treatment is argon laser trabeculoplasty and selective laser trabeculoplasty. And surgical treatment is trabeculectomy. Trabeculectomy provides a definite and permanent reduction of intraocular pressure within safe limits in majority of cases where the medical treatment or laser treatment is not working or unable to control the intraocular pressure. Laser trabeculoplasty, as I told you, it is ALT and SLT. What are the indications? When the person is already on medical treatment, that 2-3 drugs, here prostaglandins are also given, analogs, beta blockers are also given, and topical carbonic anhydrase inhibitors are also given. In spite of giving 3 drugs, the intraocular pressure of the person is not to the target limit. In those patients, we will do laser trabeculoplasty. Some non-compliant patients who are unable to take the topical treatment for long duration or they are unable to put the drops regularly, in those cases, patients, we can do this trabeculoplasty laser as primary treatment. How to do it? We apply nearly 50 to 100 burns to the junction of pigmented and non-pigmented trabecular meshwork. So as we can see in this picture, so this is the pigmented and this white portion is non-pigmented. So at this junction, we give this round, this is a laser spot. So we give around 50 to 100 laser spots throughout 360 degrees. In this picture, I am trying to show what is the correct focus of the laser beam and what is the incorrect focus of the laser beam. If the laser beam is correctly focused, the burn will be circle, in a well smooth circle. And if the laser beam is incorrectly focused, it will not be a circle, it will be oval like this. As you can see here, this is oval. So this is laser trabeculoplasty. Next is trabeculectomy, that is a surgical treatment. What are the indications of trabeculectomy? When the medical treatment and laser treatment, both of them have failed, or there will be trabeculoplasty, that person is not suitable, but he is already on medical treatment with uncontrolled IOP. So we'll go last thing is trabeculectomy procedure. So trabeculectomy procedure, there are two things. Conjunctival flaps are made, fornix base and nimble base. So this I'm showing is fornix base, conjunctival flap. And then we will make a spiral flap. And then we'll make a window, small window out of it. And that from that window, we do peripheral arrectomy and then we close the scleral flap and we'll close the conjunctival flap. This procedure I will tell you in detail now. See these pictures. This first picture, what we are doing is cutting the conjunctiva. Then we are undermining the conjunctiva. Then we are clearing the limbal portion with a knife. See, here, this is picture 2. Then we are making a small 1 millimeter by 1 millimeter scleral flap This is around 3 by 3 millimeters. 3 by 3 millimeters clear flap. Then this flap will lift with a small forceps, as you can see here. And now this picture is clear, that sclera is here and the flap is lifted. Then we do small parasynthesis to decrease the intraocular pressure. We do tap a small amount of aqueous from the anterior chamber. Then after that we make a small window of 1 by 2 millimeter window, 1 millimeter by 2-3 millimeter window is made in this scleral flap. From this window we can see the iris. This we can see the iris. This iris will lift and cut here. So this is called peripheral iridectomy. So what we are doing is we are lifting and cutting the iris, peripheral iridectomy. And then we resuture this scleral flap and this conjunctival flap, you can see above, this resuture here. So the final picture after trabeculectomy, suturing all the flaps will look like this. Here you can see there is a portion of the iris has been removed. This is called peripheral iridectomy, and conjunctival flap is sutured here. So this white is filled with aqueous, this is blood. So the final picture after trabeculectomy is that. Then if there is trabeculectomy also failed, how to manage that? You have to do digital massage of the globe. We can do laser suture lysis. We can use topical steroids for refunctioning of the flap, or we can inject 5-fluorouracil so that there will not be adhesion or fibrosis in the flap. Or we can reoperate. We can make another window, another flap on superior nasal or temporal aspect of the eye. Or we can recommence to the medical therapy in full dose. So this part, these are the management of primary open angle glaucoma. So what we have covered today is definition. Then we have covered about the aqueous drainage diagram. Then covered the classification, clinical introduction about the primary open angle glaucoma, then clinical features, investigation, and treatment of primary open angle glaucoma. This completes a main question, which is very important and the most commonly asked question for undergraduate in final intensity exam.